It is a good and glorious thing to be here on this bright and beautiful day, gathered here for worship, to listen for God's voice, to sing God's praise together, to walk our walk of faith with each other for company. It is good and grand to be together in worship. May the Holy Spirit fill this time, fill our songs, fill our prayers, fill us to overflowing with grace and joy and peace. Welcome to worship.
Good morning. It's great to see you all here this morning. If you're joining us via the TV or the internet, we hope this service is a blessing to you as you go about your faith journey. If you're a first-time visitor here in the sanctuary, we hope to see you again every Sunday here with us, and we look forward to meeting you. For those seated along the center aisle, if you would take the burgundy or maroon friendship pads and sign those and pass them down the pew, that would be of great help to those worshiping with you this morning. A few announcements. Sarah Circle will be meeting this Tuesday. That's the Sarah Circle meeting this Tuesday. Following this service here in the sanctuary, there will be a time to discover those things that are going to change as of January 1st of the next year as a result of the general conference changes that are coming forward. So you can meet here following the service. Thanksgiving dinner signups. We need help with food and preparation and cleanup. Those signups are inside the Welcome Center. There's other events on the calendar and within the bulletin. I'd ask you to pay particular attention and join in any and all that you can, knowing that all meetings here at Central are open to the congregation. It's a good chance to come and listen, and I think you'd be surprised at the deliberative thoughts that take place around those ministries. We do have a couple minute speakers this morning, and at that, I'd ask Donna and Jen to come forward to talk about the children's Christmas party.
Hi, I'm Donna. This is Jen. We are helping coordinate the
clothing center.
What you guys know as the clothing center Christmas party. This year, we're gonna name it the Christmas party for Jesus.
Birthday party for Jesus.
Sorry.
You guys know what we're talking about. Too many words.
Okay, so it's the birthday party for Jesus. I'm just going to let her talk. She does so much better at that.
So the birthday party for Jesus is going to be awesome. It's going to be December 14th. That's a Saturday. And we are going to be wrapping gifts for all the children that will be receiving gifts on Wednesday, December 11th. So that being said, we are asking for volunteers. We do need help. You could volunteer both days or one or the other. Right outside on the information tables, there's a sign up. So if you are able to help in any way, please sign up and we'll get in touch with you and see how we can all be used together. So the people have started registering to receive gifts through the Clothing Center and also through the Shepherd's Supper. And that's going to be going on the next couple weeks. And then starting next Sunday, we'll have the tree with the kids' name or gender and age on it. You guys can come take one of those off the tree. We're asking for a gift of $15. Whatever God lays on your heart to do for that would be great. And then you'll bring them back on December 8th. And then we'll get them all wrapped, and then we'll have the big old party. So you'll bring them back December 8th. We'll wrap them on the 11th, and then the party will be the 14th. So we'll remind you of dates as we get closer, but we just want to let you know that's coming and look forward to it and just pray for whatever God's going to put on your heart to help in any way. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna and Jen, for leading up that worthwhile effort. Let us be called to worship. Sing praises to the Lord who has done great things. Let us sing God's praise throughout the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy from the highest peaks to the deepest caverns.
We shout and sing for joy in the midst of our joys and our sorrows.
Shout aloud and sing for joy.
For we come to worship the God of all creation.
Let us pray together. God of peace, we confess that we are a people who fear.
We let anxiety rule our days.
Holy One.
Everybody doing good? Everybody doing good? I thought I'd talk today about how we talk to God. Do you talk to God every now and then? Anybody? Yeah? A little bit? Hi, guys. Come on up. Do you talk to God ever? Yeah? How do you do that? Do you say a prayer at night? Or do you say a prayer before you eat food? People talk... You say a prayer when you go to bed? Yep.
A short one.
When you have, before you're going to eat. So people pray to God in a whole lot of different ways. People talk to God. Some people do it with their words, right? Do you talk out loud to God sometimes? Some people do it in their heads, right? They think a prayer and they have a silent prayer inside their hearts. People talk with God all sorts of ways, right? So if you, do you, we're going to ask the grown-ups. Isn't this This is a fun game, isn't it? So, how many of you speak out loud when you're talking to God? Okay, yeah, that's a good number. How many people pray to God in the silence of your hearts? Wow, yeah. How many people kneel when you pray? Do you kneel? Okay, some people do. How many people stand up when you pray? Well, we do here sometimes, right? All people, because we do it here sometimes, right? How many people are sitting down when you pray?
All,
oh my gosh. See, all sorts of ways that people talk to God. And you know what? I bet God is listening every single time. Oh, you pray to God when you're laying down. Okay. I sometimes pray when I'm driving. Yep. How many people pray when you're driving? Oh, wow.
Two people.
I thought I was the only one.
Two people.
Two people. Yeah. Lots of people. So what does that tell us? It tells us there are lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of different ways to talk with God, right? And none of them's better than another one, is it? No? None of them's better than another.
Yeah.
However you want to talk to God, as long as you're talking to God, that's the point, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes if we're very, very quiet with our voices or with our hearts or with our minds, sometimes we can hear God talking to us. And that sounds like all sorts of different things, too. Sometimes. Okay. Sometimes God speaks to us through somebody else speaking to us. Like sometimes somebody will say something to you, and you know that's the answer you've been looking for from God. And sometimes God will speak to you in something you read or hear because you've been asking God about something and suddenly you get an answer and it's a way you didn't even expect. We can have all kinds of different conversations with God, and I hope that instead of doing all the talking, we're sometimes listening. You think we can do that? Yeah, okay. Should we have a prayer now?
Yes.
This time we're going to talk to God, but maybe this afternoon, maybe you can spend a minute and listen, all right? Can you repeat after me? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for today.
Thank you for today.
Thank you for this church.
Thank you for this church.
And everybody in it.
Everybody in it.
Thank you for listening to us.
Thank you for listening to us.
Whenever we pray. And however we pray. Help us listen for your answer. Amen. Thanks for coming up, guys.
Some have come in gladness. The first reading of Scripture comes from the prophet Isaiah. It's found in the Old Testament on page 696. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. But the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God.
At this time, I'd invite Jeff Heal to come forward and share his thoughts on stewardship. Is Jeff here?
Oh, there he is. Sneaky, aren't I? Good morning. So I did some math, and Sherry and I have been almost here for 35 years, which doesn't seem possible. So when I think of a church family, it's family, right? And as we just sang, we know that love grows here. Sometimes with families, though, over the years, you can take things for granted once in a while. You know, as we gather at Thanksgiving, sometimes we think about those things we've been taking for granted that we're really quite grateful for. As many of you know, Sherry and I have had some really tough times this summer with her parents and their health challenges. And her mother passed away just a couple weeks ago. And we needed no better reminder of the love of this church family than how people come together and support each other in these times. And our mutual commitments to the church were all covered, you know, without thought. And that level of support is just amazing. Through the process of her mother passing away, I had my first encounter with hospice services, who are amazing. And every time we had a visit, as I would lead the person out and we'd leave, I'd just say to them, I don't know how you do what you do. Every single one of them said the same thing to me when I said that. I've been through what you're going through. And it was that experience that led me to this job. And I thought, what an amazing thing to be so purpose-driven in what you're doing. It was really remarkable to hear those testaments. So as I thought about stewardship, I thought about this passage from Corinthians. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, For God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. So as we think about stewardship at this season, I invite you to think generously, but think purposefully. There are many ways to serve. Think about those things as we come together at this time. Amen.
And that brings us to a time where we present our gifts to God's purposes. Won't the ushers wait upon us?
Thank you.
may be seated. At this time, I'd call your attention to those people that we keep in our thoughts and prayers throughout the week. Specifically, on the back of your bulletin, you'll find named Marilyn and David Brzezinski, Amy Darling, James Howe, Barbara and Richard Freer, Angela LaRosa, Alexa Wales, Joanne and Chet Nezalek, Amanda Schaefer, and of particular prayers we keep in our thoughts, Gene Rusnick, Phyllis Beach, Dave and Lynn Weston, Randy and Kelly O'Brien, and Imelda Terrell.
This week, we are mindful also of another school shooting. We are mindful of families ripped apart by violence. We are mindful of parents grieving the loss of children. There's no way to comprehend how these things happen. What we hang on to is that God is with them, God is with us. As we continue to look for God, despite the horror and the fear. So our prayers are with families in California today. Our prayers are with those who are suffering the effect of wildfires also in California, natural disasters everywhere. A simple, sunny, Sunday morning for us is fraught in other places. And so we bring folks with us in prayer. But I'm also wondering where we can celebrate in prayer this morning. Where have you seen God at work in your world this week or in your life this week? Yes, Carol. Neighbors, and welcome to the Hansons this morning. Good to have you here. You know, Canoon's not here, but Canoon's here. It's terrific. Are you trying to say something, London, or not? No, okay. Where have you seen God at work in your world this week? Denise. Oh, my goodness. So Denise is celebrating the gifts of music and musicians in a blues concert and a Baroque concert, all like in the same one week. Now are you trying to say something? Okay, what?
A five-day weekend for school.
You have a what?
A five-day weekend.
Five-day weekend? Where do I get one of those? Levon.
A daughter, just celebrated her 21st birthday today, but we celebrated this weekend. And she is a junior at Binghamton University in Albany. But during Skip's illness and my inabilities, she was so much help. She was helping me grocery shop, helping me make beds. She's just a wonderful, wonderful young lady.
LaVon is celebrating her granddaughter whose 21st birthday is today. And so, you know, hitting that adulthood mile marker, but LaVon is celebrating the gifts of God she sees in her, this young granddaughter of hers, who's been such a support during this time with Skip's illness. Maggie. Maggie's celebrating the gift of conversation and friendship at Shepherd's Supper, getting to know folks who come to dinner here every single week. And you're missing out if you've never been to one. You should come sometime. Where else are we celebrating God's work this week? Well, yes. You started a new job last week. That's terrific. Shall we be in prayer? Holy and living God, we come to you this morning from all sorts of different places and situations. We come to you, some for a short season, some for years and years and years, to meet you here. We come in trust and faith that your touch can transform our lives. We come in trust and faith that no matter what happens, no matter what tomorrow brings or the next day or next week, you are with us in it and through it. In our joys, in our sorrows, you touch us and transform these moments into peace and grace. Some of us are reluctant to be here. Some of us come with joy every single Sunday, because we know the power of your touch in our lives. Help us not to take you for granted. Help us not to feel like church is the furniture of our lives, but is instead the place where we break free and learn peace and love and joy. Today, we come trusting all our cares to you, all those close to us, to you. We've named some already in our bulletin. We've listed some names for all to hear, but there are so many more we bring with us today in hope and trust of your transformative touch. There are so many we carry who are facing struggles or obstacles. We're trying to find a better way. We're trying to find hope and peace in a troubled world. Who are ill and are looking for healing. Who are worried and looking for comfort. And so in this moment, in the embrace of this community, we lift these to you as we speak their names aloud. Each one we lift is yours. Each life is a hope. Each name is a prayer. We come to you with trust, asking, Lord, in your love, hear our prayers. For we ask in the name of Jesus the Christ, as we offer to you the prayer he first taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our second reading this morning is from the Gospel attributed to Luke. As we continue with Jesus' teaching, I wish everybody was that happy to be in church. One day, people were standing around talking in the temple, remarking how beautiful it was, the splendor of its stonework and its gifts. Jesus said to them, all this that you are admiring so much, all of this, the time is coming when every stone in this building will end up in a heap of rubble. They asked him, teacher, when is this going to happen? What clue will we get that this is about to take place? And he said, watch out for doomsday deceivers. Many leaders are going to show up with false identities, claiming, I'm the one, or saying, the end is near. Don't listen to any of that. When you hear of wars and uprisings, keep your head. Don't panic. This is routine history and no sign of the end. He went on to say, nation will fight nation and ruler will fight ruler over and over. Huge earthquakes will occur in various places. There will be famines. You'll think at times that the very sky is falling. And before any of this happens, they'll arrest you, they will hunt you down, they will drag you to court, put you in jail. It will go from bad to worse. Everyone at your throat because you carry my name. You'll end up on the witness stand called to testify. Make up your mind right now not to worry about it. I'll give you the words and the wisdom that will reduce all your accusers to stammers. You'll even be turned in by parents, brothers, relatives, and friends. Some of you will be killed. There's no telling who will hate you because of me. Even so, every detail of your body and soul, even the hairs of your head, is in my care. Nothing of you will be lost. Staying with it, that's what's required. Stay with it to the end. You won't be sorry. You'll be saved. So what if I told you this morning that change is not the end of the world? Or that letting go might just gain you everything? This scripture today addresses those questions. It shows us Jesus expertly managing people's anxiety. But he does it uncomfortably. He doesn't do it by saying that everything is going to be okay. Jesus offers comfort, but he doesn't soothe. He doesn't promise sunshine and daisies. Instead, Jesus gives his hearers a lesson in God's logic, God's upside down or right side up logic. These people he's talking to are walking around the temple, oohing and aahing at all the decorations, at the artwork, at the brass plaques and the stained glass windows. Well, maybe not the plaques and the windows. And Jesus understands what they're doing for what it is. He understands these people as persons who've put their faith in the tangible instead of in God. They're hanging on to the visible. When he tells them that even this magnificent thing around them will fall, he gets their attention because surely it can't. Surely it won't. Now, they don't know that in about 40 years or so, Rome is going to destroy Jerusalem and the temple will fall into ruins. They don't know at this moment that this magnificent thing surrounding them, the seat of their faith, the place where they understand God to live, that this thing is only temporary. Because the temple for them is the symbol of permanence. The temple began as a dream of King David, who decided that the people of God should end their nomadic ways and build a place for God to live. Until that moment, the holy place was wherever they pitched a tent to house it. David believed God deserved a permanent home, and he built a wooden one. When his son Solomon came to the throne, he built a magnificent stone temple to be the home of God. By Jesus' day, that temple had been destroyed, and Herod the Great had completed a new, larger, more magnificent one around 20 years before Jesus was born. So Jesus and these people in the temple that day are admiring a 50-year-old structure in all its glory. A structure that has already become for them the very home of God. Now, can you imagine if someone suddenly told you some Sunday morning that this building and everything in it is temporary and ultimately meaningless? Wouldn't that make you anxious? 2,000 years later, those kinds of things make us anxious. Nothing is permanent. There's a poem by Percy Bysshe Shelley called Ozymandias for you, Horace. I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them, the heart that fed. And on the pedestal these words appear, my name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. People read this passage from Luke's gospel and dissect Jesus' words to decide that if he was right about the temple, what wars and future wars he might be talking about, and what earthquakes and famines and calamities he means to warn future followers about. But I am quite sure that this is not really a lesson about the future. It's not a lesson about the ultimate fate of the temple. This is a lesson about what's truly permanent. And it's a lesson about letting go. It's not the first time or the last time that Jesus will shock people by telling them to let everything go. Everything they cherish, everything they put their faith in, everything they're convinced will last forever. Jesus' stories all through the Gospels are full of the warning not to hang on to things, whether it be possessions or wealth or security or self-righteousness or overconfidence or prejudice or even fear. When you dig a little deeper into Jesus' warnings here about things to come, you can see all of that. Wars, he says, don't be anxious. Natural disasters, don't be anxious. Being arrested for your faith, don't be anxious. Families turning on you, don't be anxious. Fear not. Because none of this is the important stuff, even when it feels critical. Fear not, because everything changes. Even the things you wish desperately won't will change. The things we hold dear will pass. The people we love will break our hearts. The things we built or preserved or created will end up looking more different than we could ever have imagined, and may even, in fact, be unrecognizable to our descendants. And though it may feel crushing to consider the truth of that, none of it is ultimately important. Because the important things are intangible. How does the author say it in The Little Prince? It's only with the heart that one can see rightly. What is essential is invisible to the eye. That, my friends, is the gospel. Jesus is so much less concerned with temples and traditions and with position and power and possessions than he is concerned with people's hearts and with their relationship with God. There's a gift in being able to see through the stuff to the essential. What Jesus does time and again is cut through the junk that people build up around themselves and their faith, and he shines a light on it and in it and through it, showing it to be what it truly is. A wall they've built between themselves and God. When our time and our energy are spent managing stuff or preserving our place or focusing on these ultimately temporary things or protecting our possessions or what we claim as our possessions, we stop listening to God's Spirit. Holding tight to things seems to clench our own spirits as well. We become closed to the working of God because we're paying far too much attention to everything else. We become tense and oversensitive and anxious and depressed because we're not focused on God. The miracle comes, the true life, the abundant life that Jesus promised comes when we begin to let go. I saw a meme on the internet this week that said, once you lose all your marbles, you suddenly have both hands free. All these things we consider precious will pass. Hanging on to them more tightly won't ever change that fact. That's why Jesus tells these people in the temple the most important thing they need to know. Trust me, he says. This faith is hard, he says. People won't understand it. You won't understand the lengths to which this faith will take you or what it will ask of you. And the secret to navigating all of it, the secret to coming out of all of it intact, is trust. It is relationship with God that is permanent and lasting. Most of us, most days, are pretty bad at trusting God for everything. We hedge our bets. We hang on to an emergency supply of whatever it is we're hanging on to just in case. We hold our cards close and our money closer, and we build walls around our hearts, and we lock the Spirit out so it can't get loose in our lives because we can't begin to conceive of what lies beyond that terrifying act of trust and surrender when we finally let it all go. The glory of it is the life beyond all that is more than we can ever imagine. And that's really what we try to touch here each week, at least I hope we do. That's why churches exist in the first place, not to be the thing we cling to, but to be the place where our spirits are set free. It might be time, if your spirit hasn't felt too free lately, to wonder what you're holding on to too tightly. Because it is always the truth that when our hearts and our hands are clenched, we have no freedom. We cannot receive. We cannot give. And Jesus comes into that, not to bless our stuff, not to give us permission to hang on to it no matter what. Jesus comes instead to set us free, to open our hearts and our hands and our lives, that God can make a home. Jesus comes to set us free for that. Thanks be to God. Amen. We'll sing a song of sending. Will you stand and, as you're comfortable and willing?
Thank you.
As you go into this week and into this world, may you go with energy and excitement. May you go with open hands and open hearts. May you know what you need to let go to do that. And may the strength and the courage of the Christ go with you as you do. Amen. Thank you.